Hello, this is Brother Kevin. I'd like to welcome you to Reformation and Revival Now. And today I want to continue our series on misunderstandings. Today, our subject will be trials. Now, when we think about trials, the book of Job always comes into mind. And I don't want to get into the book of Job in detail, but I just want to say that Job didn't do anything wrong necessarily. Satan was checking him out. And God was kind of showing Job off, kind of bragging about him. And to nothing that we know of that Job did, great adversity came upon him, and his friends really weren't helping him, because actually his friends was part of the process. But when you look at the end of the book, you start realizing that Job did have some issues. Job did have some problems. So what God was doing was perfecting things in Job. And this lets you know what God was after. After all these things were taking place, and Job was really told off by Elihu, and God also told him off pretty good. After all that rebuke, God had him intercede for his friends while he was still in the midst of the sickness and the poverty and the loss and everything. And you know what? Job passed the test. In all that he was going through, he still had it in him to intercede. And of course, God turned his captivity and gave him more. Now, that's all I want to say about the book of Job right now. But you need to understand, a trial is designed to reduce you. You see, the Lord doesn't really try to take what good you have. What he likes to do is break everything you got down so that he can raise up himself in your life. So that's what trials are for. Trials are not to make you a better person. Trials are to make you like Jesus, because we might learn some things from a trial. We might learn stick-wittedness, and we might learn determination. We might learn a lot of things. That's good for us. But from God's perspective, he wants something that will make you like his son. Now, you have to remember, Jesus had nothing to gain or lose by saving us. So his whole idea, his whole heart, was just to bring salvation to mankind. And so Jesus suffered a whole lot of stuff that he really didn't have to suffer, but it was for the salvation of souls. Now, when you go through a trial, what a trial does is reduce you down so that you will live only for God. You'll live only for his purpose. You won't live so that you can become a better person and more successful after the trial. No, you want to be like Jesus. You want to be totally at God's disposal. You want to be anything that God would have you to be. That is the purpose of a trial. A trial is designed to reduce you so that the Lord Jesus, his fruit, can come out. And God is the one that brings it out. James 1 puts it this way. Let patience have her perfect work, that you might be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Okay, so when you go through trials, you get reduced. And when you are reduced, then you wait it out, or you have patience. And in that patience, in the reduction, God, through the ashes, begins to bring out the character of Jesus Christ in you. And so this is so important. You know, hey, I'm going through this trial, but when I get through it, God's going to make me stronger. Well, yeah. But here again, that's a misunderstanding. God would rather you be weaker. He would rather you be weaker. That means if you're weak and if you're diminished, he can bring up out of you anything he wants. The key is, does God have access to us? Does he have access? And what trials do is bring the reduction. It's like kind of a cross per se. He brings you down so that he can bring you up again. You see, everything is based on death, burial, and resurrection in our lives. Jesus died on the cross, yes, and was buried and rose again. But that's the same thing that God is doing in your life. He's reducing you down to nothing that he might raise you up again to be just like his son. That is what a trial is for. All right, we're going to go ahead and take a break, and we'll get into the next misunderstanding.
Thank you.
Welcome back. Now I want to talk about the subject we've all been kind of waiting for because I haven't done it. We're going to talk about faith today. And it's really hard to talk about faith without talking about Father Abraham, because the scripture says that Abraham believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness. Some translation says it was actually imputed to him. But the thing I want you to understand is that works get thrown aside here. And Abraham, by the way, did good works. But that gets put aside because he believed God. God counted it to him as righteousness. So righteousness is relational, isn't it? Of course it is. Now you need to understand that faith and hope are always, forever linked together. And Abraham was a man that it was a man of hope. He was a man of vision. God showed him the sands of the sea and the stars of the sky. And God said, if you can count them, so shall your seed be. But Abraham knew by that vision that he would be the father of many nations. Now you see that. You see that. You see vision going and faith moving. And so you need to understand that faith and hope are linked together. You can't separate Abraham from God showing him those stars and God showing him the sand of the sea, because God is saying, like, now look, your descendants that you're not even going to live to see are going to be just like this seashore and those stars up there. Okay, so Abraham gets an inner vision and his faith starts working. And it says that Abraham believed God and God gave him the gift of righteousness. So to get the basics of faith, faith is your relationship with God. Was God communicates something to you and you take corresponding actions that actually declare that you have faith in him. See, I can't say I have faith. I can only demonstrate it by my actions. Now, where does the word confession, because, you know, we had a lot of, controversy over name it and claim it and that sort of thing. And there is a truth to name it and claim it. I just have to tell you the truth. However, where faith is concerned, what your words are, so why words are so important, because words are designed to chart a course and in some cases keep you on course. Okay, so Abraham understood that he had a vision. He understood that God put something on the inside of him. With that, Abraham made his journey complete. Okay, and then his faith was tested. Now remember, I just finished talking about trials in the first half. Think about it. He was told to go and offer up Isaac, and he did. So Abraham was reduced down. Okay, he was reduced down. He had to give up his only son, and Abraham was willing to give him up. He actually lifted up the knife. And then God said, don't harm the lad. Now, why is this a great feat of faith? Why is this faith? Was it a trial? Yes, but it was also faith. Because it was saying by his actions, God, you are able to raise my boy back to life if necessary, but I will be the father of many nations, and this boy will serve you and will be the main part of my descendants. He had faith that lived in action enough to offer up his son. And it is that transaction that is a type and shadow is exactly what Jesus would do. Remember I said before in the first half that God reduces us down so that he can bring us up again. Abraham did that. See, faith knows how to take orders. Faith knows how to follow a vision. Faith will obey. And there is a relationship between faith, vision, and obedience, because your obedience is your action. It's your corresponding action. You're following the instruction from the holy vision. I like what Paul said, and I was not disobedient, O Agrippa, to the holy vision that God gave me. See, he had a holy vision. That's why he could stand before those kings there and give a faithful testimony no matter what happened to him. Well, I sure hope that this has been a blessing to you, because these little nuggets are things that we don't consider, but I want you to consider them because that's where you're walking right now. God bless you, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye-bye.